And it came on October 13th of 1973, the third message of Our Lady of Akita, which is in northwestern Japan. The bishop studied it for 8 years and consulted with Cardinal Ratzinger. I read this to you the other night, but now I want to show you that what St. Peter's talking about in the fire, Our Lady's going to talk about now. My beloved daughter, listen closely to what I now tell you and then inform your superior. As I said earlier, if humanity does not repent and amend its ways, the Father will allow a supreme chastisement to fall upon the human race. He will inflict an unprecedented chastisement, more crushing than the deluge, the flood of Noah. Without the slightest doubt, it will be a punishment such as never yet been seen. Fire will plunge from the sky. By such calamity, much of humanity will be annihilated. The clergy, as well as the laity, will perish. Any who are spared will know such suffering and desolation that they will envy the dead. The only defenses remaining to you then will be the rosary and the sign given by the sun. And the rosary would be this, because Lucia also refers to the rosary, but she means this daily consecration. The sign which the sun is given, the Blessed Sacrament. Because the bishop told us, he got that from the nun who received this message, that it's the real presence of our Lord in the Holy Eucharist, which is the sign given by the Son. So then the two pillars of our faith in this crisis are that Christ is present somewhere in the world, even if he's not going to be present in our vicinity, somewhere in the world he'll be present, because there'll be priests celebrating Mass, consecrating bread and wine somewhere. And we can make spiritual Holy Communion. If we can't receive actually the body and blood of Christ, we can at least receive him spiritually. And then Our Lady, the Blessed Virgin, the Mother of Graces, will be able to give us graces no matter where we are, even if we can't wear a scapular or a medal because it's been taken from us, for example. So that's very comforting to know. The next chapter or paragraph of this message, I read it yesterday too, deals with the same thing that Our Lady was saying at La Salette and what our Lord is saying to at Fatima, division in the church, church leaders suddenly losing their way, etc. And here's what she had to say. Every day pray the rosary on behalf of the priests and bishops. The wiles of the devil invade even the church, which is torn by internal strife. Cardinals will rise up against cardinals and bishops will confront bishops. Priests who venerate me will be hated, warred against, and vilified. The altars and churches will be vandalized. The church will abound with agents of compromise. Many priests and religious, seduced by the temptations of the devil, will betray their vows and desert their sacred call to serve the Lord. Then you can see why Our Lady at La Salette had those harsh words to say about priests becoming cesspools of impurity. She goes on to say, the loss of so many souls is at the very root of my sorrow. If these sins persist and even intensify beyond the current level, then even the forgiveness of sins will finally vanish. What she's saying is that mercy will end and then will come God's justice and punishment. Okay, I'm going to pass out to you a second sheet, and this would contain chapters 11, 12, and 13 of the Apocalypse, and we won't bother with 8, 9, and 10. I'll just briefly comment about them for you so that you can get an idea of what they're talking about. There isn't enough time to go into all of it. As a beginner, I may say that There is controversy over the apocalypse. There are those who do not see it as a book of prophecy. They would say that what John wrote would not be mainly prophecies. They would be history, or they would be consoling thoughts, trying to give the people some comfort at a time when they certainly need it. But through the history of Christianity, Catholics, Protestants, and Orthodox mainly by far have felt that this was a book of prophecy, predicting future events. It's only been in the last century, really, and even in the last 40 or 50 years, that this other thought has come along that, not prophecies, and mainly because of modernist influence. If you look at the Bible, you'll see a parallel between the Old and New Testaments. For example, the first five books of the Old Testament are history, sacred history. Then there are many, many books that are teaching books, called didactic books. And then there are many books called prophetic books. There are 12 minor prophets and 4 major prophets. The New Testament is set up the same way. The 4 Gospels and the Acts are history, sacred history of the new people. Then all those epistles, 14 of St. Paul and the others, are teaching books. And then one last book, Apocalypse, prophecy. So if that's the case, would you say that this is just a history when you've already got it up here? And it's a book of consolation? Well, anyway, they can have that view. And we can look at this book of prophecy saying John wrote it probably around 95 AD when he was in exile on the island of Patmos, which was off the coast of Asia Minor, not far from Ephesus. And since it's written in mystical language with all kinds of symbolism, where he has animals and even animals that aren't real portraying institutions or people, it's very difficult. But we can get something from it. The only problem is we cannot be too specific, so we have to be general. And with that in mind, I think we can get some valuable assistance from it, especially if we use as a guide to understand the prophecies in the apocalypse, if we use the approved apparitions of Our Lady. For example, if you read later on, we won't cover tonight, chapter 18 about this warrior, Protestant analysts of this see it as Christ coming down. First, he's going to come down and lift up a lot of people in what is called a rapture. So that would be his second coming. And then he's going to come at the end of this period of tribulation, about 7 years later, and he's going to defeat the enemy. He's the divine warrior, so that would be his third coming. Then he's going to establish a millennium of 1,000 years. And he's going to come at the end of the world, so they've got him coming 4 times. The Catholic Church's heresy. He's only coming one more time, the second coming. As he left in a cloud on Mount Olivet, the same way he'll return. So, if they have the apparitions as a guide, they would see that the divine warrior is not Christ, but a great monarch coming up in the near future who's going to be a tremendous hero of ours, also called Enoch, going all the way back to the time of Adam. Predicted that he would be a tremendous hero in the future, and that he would do this. He would establish finally, after all these thousands of years, what God wanted from the very beginning when Adam was chased out of the paradise. God wanted a one-world government, a universal kingdom of his own. Because the idea of a one-world government isn't just Satan's. Sure, he wants a one-world government, but a one-world government comes from God first of all. He wants a universal kingdom because that's the way he can save souls best. By having, first of all, church leaders dominant, state leaders second, vicars here, and then parents being vicars over families. all these vicars then can be his stand-in.